2021 is quickly coming to a close, and even though Biden's first year doesn't officially end until January 20th, it is pertinent to look back at this year, 2021, to see how Biden has done. The good, the bad, the ugly, every bit of it. Some his fault, some obviously not. And joining me now to talk about this is Jeff Waldorf, host of Around the Nation. You can find him on YouTube. Jeff, thank you so much for joining me today on Ring of Fire.
Well, thank you, Farron. I really, really appreciate the invite. I'm really happy to be here and to talk to you today.
Yeah, I mean, obviously, look, there's a lot to talk about. We've seen quite a bit with President Biden this year. And as I mentioned, you know, look, there's plenty of things that he's done that are totally his fault. Things that he hasn't done, obviously his fault. And then some things that clearly are not. But sure, you're president, you get blamed for it as part of the job. But right now, sure. he's sitting at an approval rating of what, 42% aggregate, maybe up to 44. So, you know, at this point, what needs to happen? Like, what could we do possibly, within the next month or so? Is there a way to turn that around? Because once we get into midterms, not much, I think, is going to move in the way of his polling. So what's he got to do right now to make that happen?
Well, I mean, if you're talking things that he could unilaterally do without Congress, because what Congress is, it's just basically a dead end. He can't get anything done. Manchin and Sinema, they're going to block every single thing that comes across their desk. And so if you're talking unilateral action, two things right off the bat: cancel student loan debt and legalizing cannabis, marijuana, or at least rescheduling it to something that's no longer Schedule One, which it's still insane to think that it's considered to have absolutely no medicinal value when we know that that's not the truth. That's not backed up by facts and science. And what did Biden say? I thought he said he was going to follow the science. Interesting.
Well, and you know, it's funny that you pointed out those two things, because those are the exact same two things that I've been pointing out. And I think at this point, that is what Biden has to do. He has to do something from him. You know, we're coming up on Christmas season. Biden, you've got to give us a present. This cannot be a group present from the whole Democratic Party. People need to see that you are doing something to make their lives better. Because when the midterms roll around and they ask the question like they always do, are you better off today than you were 2 years ago? I mean, honestly, look around. These people are going to say no. No, they're not. Right. Not much has changed. And of course, we have the, you know, scaled down infrastructure package that has been signed into law. But a lot of that can't even become a reality without Build Back Better, which is still being whittled down. God only knows what that's going to be. And you're relying on your Manchins, your Sinemas, your testers, just this handful of individuals who say, nope, I'm going to obstruct just for the sake of obstructing. And of course, donor wishes, but it's just dooming this entire party. And we're all watching this happen. You and I, we do this every day. And we read the news all day, and we just watch it happen in slow motion. And all we can do is warn people. But, you know, at the end of the day, you and I don't get to make the laws. We don't get to vote on these things. And so it does get difficult to watch all the horrible things happen, because, you know, we need this legislation and it's not happening.
Well, let me just say, too, look, Biden had already foreshadowed his presidency. All of this was already set to happen. Why? Well, it's when he told the donors, nothing will fundamentally change. So we're not expecting a gift. We're not expecting a gift to the voters. Unless, of course, you count the Fox News tree burning down. That is kind of funny. But no, as far as anything to make people's lives materially better, I mean, yes, you can count the good, because we are fair and balanced. You know, we can count the child tax credits. No, that's a fantastic idea. Those have gone out to, you know, millions of families. It's great. Republicans hate it. Even I think there are even some Democrats that hate it. But that was a good thing. That does help to increase the, you know, material conditions for the average American. But without those other things, without childcare, without, you know, paid family leave, not even the paltry 4 weeks, we should be having 12, but we've got nothing. And that's all of a result, as you said, a couple of people who, thanks to donor interests who do not want this, and because of the failure of the Democratic Party, and you can even point at progressives for not pushing the, you know, make sure the bipartisan infrastructure bill and Build Back Better were passed together. They did not follow through. They did not hold the line on that promise. With that, since bipartisan infrastructure passed, we're not getting Build Back Better. It's not happening. We're not getting a gift. We're getting coal in our stockings, which, by the way, Joe Manchin absolutely loves.
Well, and of course, you know, we can't not talk about the fact that Joe Biden single-handedly, as we all know, destroyed the supply chain. I don't know how he did it, but if you watch any conservative media, Joe Biden has ruined commerce here in the United States. So this is a good example, though. This is one thing, for the most part, I guess you would say, Biden doesn't have control over the supply chain. It's a bad thing that is happening, obviously. It was happening last year when store shelves literally were empty, unlike now. You know, you couldn't find, obviously, toilet paper, but paper plates, paper towels, canned soup was gone last year, you know, from April to June, roughly, and it still hasn't bounced back. But it's all Biden's Farron. Fault, right?
Are you sure that the soup isn't because of Antifa? because, you know, they like soup.
For their families.
For their families. Yes. But now you bring up a great point when you talk about how they're blaming Joe Biden for the supply chain issues. This is a result of COVID. This is a result. I don't think any president, honestly, could have anticipated that this would happen. Even, and I'll say something controversial, even Donald Trump probably couldn't have seen this happen and wouldn't have had much control over this. Right. Now, again, if you want to talk about response to the pandemic, as far as what he did wrong in order to prolong it, in order to make it worse, fine. But you still also will have always had these supply chain issues during this time because of economic forces outside of their control. You have factories, for example, all over the world. Again, this isn't just an American virus. The conservatives always love to point at Wuhan and China. Well, China is where we get a lot of stuff of our stuff manufactured. And it shut down China. And it shut down a lot of manufacturing all over the world, which is creating the supply chain. And by the way, something that also needs to be addressed as well is labor. Okay, we're going to talk about labor. We're going to talk about the Great Resignation is what they're calling it, where people are quitting their jobs, mainly COVID. That's a big part of it. A lot of people retired as a result of COVID. And that economic issue, you also have a result of childcare. You also had over 780,000 Americans that have died from COVID that are no longer in the workforce. And you've got shortages everywhere. And I've done numerous stories after story after story of how badly people in the service industry were treated during the time of COVID. And so that's the staffing shortage, but that's not necessarily related to the supply chain. But what is truckers. There's a trucker shortage. And it's not because there's not people willing to be a trucker. It's that the pay has not kept up. And the pay is now nowhere near it needs to be to sustain a large trucking base.
Well, and Republicans have also turned around and they've said, well, part of the problem is Buttigieg. Buttigieg goes on paternity leave. And because of that, you know, you've got the ships that are off the coast of California. And it's so ridiculous. Look, if you want to criticize Buttigieg for anything other than paternity leave, I'll hear you out on that. But that's an idiotic argument. And of course, they're using it. That's part of the culture war issue because he's paternity leave because he's a man. Also, he's not a straight man. Oh, God, that gets the Republicans all drummed up and crazy. And that's why they're doing it. It's not because they actually think he's part of the supply chain problem. It's to remind people that he's a gay man. And it works.
Let me just add to that as well. It's not just about, I mean, yes, definitely part of the culture wars. But it's not just the fact that he's a gay man. It's just the fact that he's basically promoting the idea by taking paternity leave himself that, hey, fathers and mothers, paid leave. You don't want that. Paid leave bad because look at Buttigieg. You don't like Buttigieg because he's gay and he's immoral, right? And he took paternity leave. That means you shouldn't take paternity leave either. Nobody should have paternity leave. Get back to work. Get back to the mines.
Yeah. And we've certainly seen them say that, you know, that nobody should have. Lauren Boebert, you know, she used the argument that because she gave birth to one of her kids in a car, nobody should get maternity leave either. Now, I'm not sure what the correlation is there, but that's what she said. Also, totally not surprised that that woman gave birth in a car. She not seems like that is like right on par, especially with her new little Christmas card out, completely tasteless. The kids look like they're in a friggin' hostage video. None of them look happy to be there, but they're all posing there with their crazy expensive weapons of death. And she's just grinning like a big absolute moron behind them because this is Al-Qaeda. That's who they are.
Yep.
And it's sick, especially in the wake of what happened last week. But absolutely. But that's what we, and by we, I mean like me and you and everybody else in this industry, not necessarily the Democratic Party, but that's what we're up against. Because we have to go against that every day. We have to talk about these things. We have to remind people this is not normal. Because if we don't, the right-wing echo chamber is so much bigger, so much better funded than we are, that they're going to win the day. And eventually, those Christmas cards with your AK-47s become the norm here in America. It's not a fun task, but there's really not enough of us out here doing this either. And that's, you know, sad enough as it is.
No, absolutely. Let me just go back to the hostage video, right? Or the hostage picture. Are you sure it's not the camera people that are the hostage? People taking the picture, you know, walking in. Oh, my God. What have I come into? Walked into? Oh, no. Take our picture or else. Make it extra jolly.
I mean, I would feel threatened if I received that in the mail. Oh, you know, yeah. I mean, that almost.
Like, what are you trying to tell me here?
Exactly. That's the war on Christmas, really. So you know, to bring this all back, obviously, talking about Biden's first year, and again, the Lauren Boebert thing does tie in because he's also up against the crazies that have taken over the party. Your Lauren Boebert's, your Taylor Greens, your Gateses, who for some reason still hasn't been indicted, your Jim Jordans, your Gohmerts, your Gozars. The list is increasing in the number of just absolutely deranged individuals that are constantly lobbying baseless attacks on the left. And again, they appear to win the day because it's hard to refute something that is patently untrue. Now, again, we try it, the Democrats try it every day. But when they just make something up and all you can say is, no, that's not true, you know, people say, well, but what's your proof? And the proof is because it's just made up. You know, there's no evidence to show it's not true because it's just something they created. Like if they say they saw a dragon fly over their house today, all we can sit and say is, no, you didn't. Well, where's your proof that I didn't? The proof is dragons don't exist. I mean, you know, that's a good, I think, analogy of the kind of lies these people create that does become harder. And when they create them about this administration and they blame him for the supply chain, people don't understand the supply chain. They don't know what it means. Right. If you can't explain it in 10 seconds, they're gone. And so that's a big part of the problem, too.
Sure. And just let me just add that, you know, shouldn't the burden of proof be on the people making extraordinary claims?
In the past, I mean, it used to be, yeah.
It's supposed to be. But obviously, going back to the list of clowns that you had just mentioned, I don't see that they're fighting enough or hard enough against the disinformation. And I'm not saying like things like, oh, you should, you know, arrest them or whatever, or you know, censor them, silence them. But you know, fight back. I mean, as Joe Biden, I don't think Joe Biden has done enough to really publicly fight back against a lot of this stuff, a lot of what's been mainstreamed in the Republican Party. And I go back to statements made by he and other members of the Democratic Party saying things like, well, you know, going back to even to Obama, the fever would break, right? Fever did not break. In fact, it got worse and it spread throughout the entire party. And yet, you know, you have Democrats that are saying things like, well, we need a strong Republican Party. We need the Republicans to get back to reality. We need Republicans. We need a strong Republicans. And it kind of betrays their thinking, in my view, of where they feel like they need Republicans to be a check on the left, on progressives. And I think that's their biggest obstacle that I've always seen. And you could see it through Build Back Better negotiations, how quickly they were able to fold to the mansions and the cinemas and the testers and the goons and, you know, Chris Coons and all them, all these corporate Democrats fold to them because they're on the side and they want to use those moderates, so-called moderates. I don't believe they're moderate at all. And Republicans to quell the voices on the left and the left's policy prescriptions, which, by the way, are massively in line with what the American people want. You look at any of the polling on any of these policy positions, you know, childcare, paid leave, et cetera, massive majorities of the country, even Republican voters as well, the very people who are being swindled by the people that are in power, you know, their elected representatives, the crazies, they support this stuff.
So it is remarkable, you know, when you see the polling on the issues and and this has been this way for years, the public goes left. Like they go hard left on the issues, including, again,
what's considered hard left.
Right. You know, everywhere else, it's just normal. It's centrism is what it is. But here in America, it's considered far left. But even Republicans go that way. When you divorce it from a political party, they go even further. When you start talking about universal health care, if it's tied to a party, support for it goes down. When you just talk about what if we provided health care coverage for everybody, even Republicans say, oh, yes, I want that. I like that. But then you talk about the Democrat plan to do that, they say, well, no, absolutely no. So we have a real weird divide, and a lot of it is driven by this purely partisan team sports type nature that we have. But overall, the policies are popular. Biden is not. And these are things that he is pushing. Mm-hmm. So he, in my opinion, has to do a better job of selling this. Where did the Biden go who got so excited about the Affordable Care Act being signed, you know, that he's like, oh, it's a big deal. And he had energy. This Biden is like he's low on batteries here. And you hear him talk and come on, dude, wake the hell up. Show us
Adderall and get at him, guys.
Right. I mean, the public is used to that. Obama had charisma and energy, and he was a good speaker. Trump, horrible speaker, but he had energy. Mm-hmm. People do want that, and Biden is either just not able to do it anymore, or he has the world's worst handlers who say, no, don't get bombastic, don't be like Trump. I don't know which it is. I think it's probably a combination of both. Probably. But if he can't sell it, he's doomed for the next 3 years.
And going back to my, you know, what I think about that is he's got to want to sell it, you know? Yeah. And that's really my biggest criticism is it doesn't really feel like he's at all interested in the things that he ran on. And that understand that this is why his poll numbers are in the garbage. He's not fighting for the things. Again, Bernie Sanders has done a better job at fighting for the Biden agenda than even our own. And by the way, you know, this is coming from somebody who's to the left of Bernie Sanders and some issues, where I'm saying, hey, Bernie Sanders is fighting harder for the Biden agenda than Biden is, and is kind of ignoring our agenda. I mean, he's not talking. He is, you know, he'll tweet about Medicare for All and things like that, but he's been mainly focused on fighting for, you know, for example, expanding Medicare to include vision and dental, you know, two things that are very important that, again, are very incredibly popular, allowing Medicare to negotiate drug pricing, very popular things like that, that are good things and I would love to see passed, and also fighting for other stuff that was supposed to be in Build Back Better. And we don't see that same energy from Joe Biden. We don't see that same energy from the Democrats. In fact, what little there is in Build Back Better, which, by the way, there are good things in it, but what little is left after being stripped away, you have Democrats out there, and unfortunately some progressives even, that are saying, oh, historic. It's historic. Yeah. No, it's what's historic about it is how much you've allowed it to be gutted. This started at $6 trillion, went down to 3.25, I believe, now to 1.9. Now it's like 1.7. It's we're going to be left with a coupon for Denny's and 2 cents. Okay.
It certainly feels that way. And another thing here, too, on the Republican side, is the fact that Mitch McConnell is now so confident that he announced, you know, to his party members, to the lobbyists, the donors, he said, we're not even putting out a platform for 2022. We're literally running on nothing because nothing can beat, in Mitch McConnell's mind, and Mitch McConnell's not stupid, okay? Right. He is an evil SOB, but he is smart, and I will give him credit for that. But he says, listen, I don't even have to come up with a platform. I don't have to do anything other than watch this party over here fight amongst itself, have this low energy president, and I'm going to win. And that tells us a lot. I mean, again, Mitch McConnell can read a room better than anybody. And if he's already saying that, you know, these Democrats are in trouble in less than a year now, less than a year. And I don't know if they can turn it around. I really, truly don't know. And honestly, don't think they can.
They could if they wanted to. Going back to this, this is an issue of political will. And the reason that I say that is that Joe Biden, look, being president is a very powerful position. And he's not exercising that power. And again, going back to why we're so disappointed in him, or I should say why a lot of progressives are disappointed. I actually am not disappointed. This is about what I expected. So you come in with low expectations, you're going to, you know, you're not going to get disappointed. Yeah. Because we, again, you know, nothing will fundamentally change. He told us that, well, his donors, but we knew that from the outset. And so, you know, I'm not at all surprised. I'm not at all bummed out. I'm not at all really, I'm just, I mean, it sucks that we're not going to get Build Back Better. But again, you could see it in the cards. You could see that he was not going to fight for this. And you can, of course, see that the Republicans are absolutely giddy, as well as the donor class. The donors are incredibly happy with Kyrsten Sinema, Joe Manchin, the rest of the corporate Democrats for shooting down these very, you know, again, popular proposals that would have actually helped regular people. And as far as the midterms that are coming, again, you said it right. Mitch McConnell is not a stupid person. Man's an evil genius. Someone like that can stay in power for so long. And if he's not running on anything, that is a really bad message. That shows that the current Democratic plan is an absolute failure. But going back to what he could actually do, as I mentioned, there's two things that he could have done. And I mentioned at the top of the show, there's another one too. Reproductive rights are under assault right now in an unprecedented way. Again, Texas with their anti-abortion laws. And now you have the Supreme Court literally hearing a case on Roe v. Wade. This is a conservative Supreme Court. Joe Biden, if he had the political will, could take a page out of, some older president's books and start stacking the courts. Pack the courts. Could do that. He doesn't have the political will. There are other things, of course, he could do. Put pressure on Joe Manchin to support his agenda. Hey, I hear that there are some issues with Heather Bresch, the former CEO of what was that company that made the EpiPen?
Yeah, the Mylan.
Mylan,
yeah.
Pharmaceuticals. There might be a little bit of a legal issue there. You might want to check that out, Joe Biden. Just saying, Merrick Garland, you've got your work cut out for you. Do your job. Put some pressure on. And I know, and I know it sounds like it shouldn't, you know, like, hey, oh, that's uncool. You shouldn't do stuff like that. It's dirty tricks and dirty tactics. Don't care.
Yeah.
I care about winning. I care about policy most of all. And I also care about stopping fascism, which right now the Republican Party is engaged in and the Democratic Party is enabling.
They really are. And you know, when you talk about the Supreme Court, we did have that commission, you know, that he put in place earlier this year. They finally came out and they said, all right, here's our plan. Term limits, which you would have to have, you know, a constitutional amendment to do. But I wholeheartedly support term limits for this court, as do obviously a majority of people in this country. But I'm also not opposed to just expand the damn court. Just do it. And the argument against it is so dumb. But then Republicans are going to do it. Cool. Then when you take power, do it again. Put 200 justices on that court. I don't care. It's a joke anyway now. If past cases are not considered the law of the land and you could just overturn them willy-nilly, then the court has lost its entire function and nothing matters anymore. So put 200 people, make it everybody in the country is a Supreme Court justice. Fantastic. We all get the job.
Great in those robes.
Yeah, and we just, we text our vote every time, you know, like we're watching American Idol. That's how we vote on Supreme Court cases, because we're all idiots anyway. And I'm sorry, just that issue is so stupid.
It is.
That I simply say, four justices, why stop there? Put 40 if you want. Make them, and choose people that are like 25 years old. Do it so they can sit there for 60 damn years. And it doesn't matter. Nothing matters. And sometimes, you know, you don't want to hit that cynical point, the nihilistic to hell with everything, but it's difficult. It's difficult to be immersed in this every single day.
Right.
And not every now and then succumb to that. And unfortunately, on the issue of packing or expanding the Supreme Court, that's where I've just become so cynical that nothing matters. Everything is stupid and we should make a joke of it anyway.
That's how I diffuse that is with humor. You know, every time you want to get blackpilled, you know, you just, I mean, you have to laugh at some of the absurdity that's going on in today's system and how the only argument for keeping some of these very outdated systems in place is that, well, we've just always done it this way. Yeah, but why not do something better?
Yeah.
And I think that's the argument that's always used against any social or economic progress. And we have to fight that.
So, Jeff, there's another thing I want to talk to you about real quick here. I know I've already kept you longer than I told you I would, but...
Oh, totally fine. Enjoying this.
I do have to bring this up because you are a lot like me in this regard. Mm-hmm. There is so much... Okay, because we've talked about Biden, we've talked about Republicans, all that. Okay, let's go to leftist media for a minute. There's a lot...
Before that, can I just add in one more point about Biden as well?
And
by the way, I want to give him credit. Okay, because we've spent this whole time saying that, you know, he doesn't get any credit for being strong. One thing that I give him absolute credit for, leaving Afghanistan. I think that was one of the best decisions of his entire presidency. I will defend him to the hilt. Corporate media has been savaging him. Right-wing media savaged him. You know, they're saying all these things about, oh, not, you know, you left $87 billion worth of equipment in Afghanistan. You know, why didn't you bring it back? Well, it would have been more expensive to bring it back. Plus, the stuff's already broken down by now. Without material and supplies, those things don't last very long. So I read into that. They're very difficult with the upkeep. They probably don't even have that stuff anymore. It's all broken down, except for maybe some of the small arms. But I will give them credit for that. Mainstream media, fear-mongering, war-mongering, as usual, of we need to protect women's rights. Well, again, as I mentioned with the Supreme Court, we can't even protect women's rights here in Texas or any other place in the United States. Here in Florida, it's probably something similar is coming your way. And so that's a ridiculous argument. And again, to go to the point where people are blaming Biden for things that are not his fault, gas prices. The thing that irritates me the most is when people talk about gas prices, thanks, Biden. You know, it's a continuation of thanks, Obama. And it's ridiculous. The president does not control gas prices. You can go all the way back to George W. Bush when he said, oh, I wish I had a magic wand and low gas. I don't have it, though. I don't have that magic wand. Well, Joe Biden doesn't have a magic wand either. Donald Trump didn't have a magic wand. In fact, gas prices were still pretty expensive under Donald Trump. Again, a result of COVID. But also you have OPEC Plus. You have the fact that we don't actually have domestic energy. That is a complete fabrication. That's not a real concept. Domestic American energy. Can you, like, it frustrates me when I see people peddle that, because it's not real. It's pumped out of the ground here by multinational corporations, sent to refineries in Texas, again, owned by multinational corporations, sold on the global market, bought, and then we buy it back, or we buy it from somewhere else, from another global, you know, multinational corporation, and then gas stations and companies get to put whatever price they want on it. And guess what? They have made billions and billions of dollars of essentially what is price gouging and calling it inflation. That is not Joe Biden's fault. I don't think there's a whole lot he can do about it other than invest in, make a gigantic investment in renewable energies, which again, there's been some modest investment. I think there needs to be more. I think they need to get really, really serious about climate change and stop opening up drilling permits in the Gulf and doing things like that. But again, the whole idea that you can pin squarely gas prices on the president, it doesn't matter what president it is, it's just complete and utter garbage, total fabrication, complete lies, gaslighting, whatever you want to call it. It's BS. And I'm sorry, I'm trying to fight the urge to swear.
No, it's the look, I agree with everything you said right there. Those are definitely good points to bring up. So again, I do want to shift for a moment, because like I said,
sure,
leftist media, there's not a ton of us out there doing this. We need more voices out there, but this whole year, and even way longer than that, to be perfectly honest, there's been a lot of fights. There's been a lot of back and forth, you know, this person, oh, I'm pissed at this person. And a lot of it has to do with, we've got plenty of people that are allegedly on the left that have gone so far left that they're clearly on the right at this point. But I will say, and I wanted to applaud you for this, you've done a wonderful job of not getting just sucked in to so much of this drama. I mean, I do, you know, I see you respond to things on social media, and I do as well sometimes, but for the most part, is it helpful to get involved in these fights? Or, because I'm of the mind, and I avoid it. Look, I despise a lot of those people. They would never know it because I don't say it. Mm-hmm. But I to me, it's like, ignore them. I blocked Glenn Greenwald on Twitter over a year ago. And it was wonderful. And it's not because he's harassing me. It's because I'm tired of seeing his bull crap. I'm blocking him. We've never interacted. And I'm blocking him because I'm tired of other people retweeting it onto my damn feed. He's a loon now, a right-wing hack, clearly. And so to me, it's always just been, you know what, screw it, ignore it, block him, move on. Don't get dragged down to their level. But some people do it really well. So I'm not, you know, attacking the folks who do get involved. But I do want to say, I like that you're kind of like me as well with that regard. Like, we could get in there and just start shit with everybody we want. But at the end of the day, what's the point? Really, kind of, what's the point?
I mean, you know, I don't like getting involved because I don't care. I'm here to do, I mean, I'm here to give my opinion. I'm here to do the news. I'm not here to start, you know, fights with other people, with other creators. I could care less, for the most part, what they do. I have been a little bit concerned, though, with the anti-vax stuff that I've been seeing from certain people. I'm not comfortable with that. Because, I mean, if you go back to the earliest videos on my channel, it's me crapping on anti-vaxxers. So this is not a position that is new for me. I've always held contempt for people who despise science or who don't care about actual science. And so I've also noticed as well for a long time that the left has always had a bit of a, and I'm not saying like the entire left, as some small portion of the left does have some anti-vax tendencies. And I do understand where some of that comes from. You and I, we know, like, y'all know, we're not the biggest fans of big pharma, okay? The pharmaceutical industry is an industry driven by greed. We can all agree with that. That doesn't dispute the science, though. It doesn't dispute the science behind COVID vaccines or any of the other medication. The problem with big pharma has always been its business practices and its lobbying practices. It's always been the fact that there is greed. I think we should nationalize the pharmaceutical industry. I don't think there should be a profit motive in healthcare whatsoever. That would solve that problem. So then you couldn't say, that would deflate a lot of the anti-vax rhetoric that we see on the left is, oh, well now big pharma, there's no profit motive. Oh, Oh, okay. So when the science is sound, great. Vaccines, good. You know, there's that. And that's my big problem. But generally, as I said, I'm not getting anything done if I'm fighting with other people. You know what I'm saying? I'm here to fight fascism. I'm here to stop the right wing. I'm here to do, to promote good policy positions. Doesn't matter where they come from. You know, if a right winger comes up with a good policy position, great. I'm in favor. Let's do it. Right. If, you know, if it comes from the centrists, I'll be in favor. Tim Ryan, for example, floated the $2,000 monthly, what is it, stimulus check during coronavirus. I thought that was a great idea. Tim Ryan's a centrist. He's a center, you know, centrist Democrat. Doesn't matter. If you come up with a good idea, I'm going to support a good idea. But if you say you're in my side and you come up with terrible ideas, well, then I'm going to attack the ideas. I'm not going to attack the messenger. I'm going to attack the ideas. Because really, all you're doing when attacking the messenger is galvanizing the fans, the fan base. Because let's be honest, we've been in this career for quite some time. And we know that we get a little bit of a parasocial relationship with our fans, with our followers. People tune into us. They see us every day. They identify with us. They trust us. And that's a wonderful, beautiful thing, that knowing that there are so many people out there that get the trust in the things that we say. It should make us more galvanized to do better, to honor that trust by giving them good information, fact-based information, and good perspectives, fair perspectives, but also a perspective that we share in progressive politics. There are people, I think, that are abusing that trust. You know, when you fight, when you have two of these creators fight, their fans often get involved and start sending kind of the worst kind of messages. I've gotten them before. Even if I haven't interacted with certain people, certain creators, I've still received some of those messages from followers of said person or people or groups or whatever. And it's just like, I ain't got time for this. At the end of the day, I don't have time for it. I got a job to do. I've got people to inform, and let's, you know, leave the petty infighting for someone else. and by the way, not everybody, and let me just, you know, address, because I have friends that have been attacked by this. Okay. By certain people, certain groups that you were talking about. And these attacks are vicious. And I am in no way calling the people defending themselves against these attacks petty.
Right.
And that's, I think that's an important distinction to point out. Defending yourself is fine, but willingly injecting yourself or starting drama. And I think there's a reason for that, of course, clicks and views, et cetera, because drama is very, very popular on all social media, video platforms, et cetera. I mean, like you and I, if we started drama with somebody or with each other, you know, imagine that, right? Or just stage like a drama, like, oh, Farron, you bald son of a bee. Oh, wait, that wouldn't work. But if you did, clicks and views. And so there's a financial incentive. And that's just the nature of capitalism, I think.
It is. And look, I don't want to say that all the blame lies on one side. But when you talk about, you know, starting the drama, we all see... Mm-hmm. Who does it? So it's
there are certain people who are attracted to drama. That's for sure.
Is. So anyway, I had to get your take on that because sure. Again, you know, you're a lot like me, and it's like, you know what? Just shut the hell up. Like, we've got so many problems facing this country, facing our lives, that I don't care what he said about screw it, like go away. Or DM each other and work it out. You know, the few people I've ever had, you know, some kind of disagreement with, we worked it out privately in DMs, and now everything's cool and has been for years. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you could do that, or you can get the clicks, and I think we all know what most people are choosing.
Right. And there is one thing to say, too, about being responsible with your platform. If you do have a lot of people, I think you do have a responsibility to be a responsible person and put out a fact-based message. And, you know, if you're not doing that, I think it is fair to criticize that, you know, and certain financial motives. But beyond that, I mean, just starting drama, just to start drama. I mean, you know, again, I'm never in favor of that. I'll avoid it. I'll avoid it. And you're right. If you do have criticisms, you could first work it out on DMs first. And that's what I mean by kind of calling out the drama. And then if, you know, if I guess if it persists, then you might want to do maybe something to point it out and say, look, this is what's going on. I told that person that this is an issue and that you're, you know, being very irresponsible with the platform that you have. And they didn't listen. And so now here's the call out.
Yeah. And look, I am okay with that too. And we've seen that, you know, Anna with TYT has had to do that so much this year, completely unfair, because you've got that whole gaggle of folks that have ganged up on her and it's so horrible. But listen, I will leave it at that. Jeff, tell everybody where they can find you.
Well, you can go to my YouTube channel, youtube.com/WaldorfNation. We put out videos every day. So check those out. We get a live show at 4 p.m. Eastern. So tune into that. Yes, we do it live. we're also on Facebook at Jeff Waldorf Show. Twitch, if you're all interested in Twitch, checking out that community there. Very small, very tight-knit community, very nice people. twitch.tv/Jeff Waldorf. And you can follow me on Twitter at Jeff's Politics as well. That's it. That's how you can find me.
Jeff, wonderful conversation today. Thank you so much for joining me.
Well, thank you so much, Farron. I enjoyed it immensely. Let's absolutely do this again. A lot of fun.